Hey guys, what is up YouTube? It's your boy Zach here. I'm with Bemani Lounge. For those of you who don't know me, I also co-host our podcast with Henry, so shout outs to you. And today guys, I want to talk to you about Subterrors. It's a deck that I'm probably the best known for. You might have seen me on Kawhi's channel, I'm So Angry, so if you haven't, go ahead and check that out as well. But Subterrors, I've just recently come back into the metagame and I played in our Adamancipator deck core tournament last night and I ended up taking first place in that. And so I just wanted to share with you guys my Subterrror list. So without further ado, here we go. For the main deck, we've got three copies of Ash Blossom and Joyous Spring. I think it's probably just the most generic hand trap ever printed, so it really needs no further explanation. It did come up a couple of times, but honestly, I think hand traps are pretty weak at the moment. We've got three copies of Subterrror Fiendess. It's definitely one of the best cards in the deck. Three copies of Subterrror Guru. The best card in the deck for sure. One copy of Nemesis Archer and one copy of the Behemoth Umastrix, or just the Lizard. There's a lot of debate in the Subterrror community on like what is the correct ratio of how many archers or do you play Umastrix. And I've played a lot of different versions where I played like two archer and no lizard, or one and one, or just one archer and no lizard, or even more, I've played two archer and one lizard before. And for right now, I feel like the best approach is to take one and one, because the Umastrix is really good for just banishing cards and getting in for a lot of damage, because you want to end games as quickly as you can. A lot of times you are the beatdown when you're playing this deck. And so I feel that one and one is fine. You are going to draw the Umastrix sometimes. There's nothing you can do about that. In top four, I drew the Umastrix and bricked completely. I had no monsters to summon, so like, it just be like that sometimes. But yeah, that's it for the monsters. Pretty low count. We have three copies of Hidden City, obviously best card in the deck, and the one Terraforming to search it out. And then we have three Pot of Greed, Pot of Extravagance. Two Pot of Duality, it cuts me deep having to cut the third Pot of Duality, because I am a firm believer in playing all of your consistency cards at max copies. But the Pot of Duality does sometimes conflict when you draw the Umastrix and you do want to special summon it, or in the late game if you need to summon with Fiendess to get Guru back. So I think it's okay to play two, but I mostly am only playing two just for space reasons. Which brings me to my next card, two copies of Called by the Grave. I see people not playing this card, and I feel like it's just too good not to play. I wouldn't play three, but sometimes you just need your Hidden City to resolve, and if they Ash, then you just lose. So Called by the Grave gets in there and helps make sure that that resolves. You also are able to banish things like Eldritch. I used it to banish a Block Dragon, and that was really clutch. So Called by the Grave is just, it's really strong right now, and I wouldn't not play it. And next up, we have probably the three MVPs of the whole deck. One copy of Mystic Mine, one copy of Necro Valley, and then one copy of Set Rotation. Mystic Mine won me my top four match pretty much single-handedly. I was going second against Adamancipator, and I drew only Ash as a form of interaction, and they excavated Kawaki Meru Guardian off of the first Adamancipator. So I was like, well, I guess I might as well not play it. And then I top-decked Mystic Mine, and they had only ended on the one Boreload Savage, and the Buster Lock, and like Masquerena, and all that other shenanigans, but it was only one negate. So I just baited the negate with Pot of Extravagance, and then I stuck the Mystic Mine, and that won me game one. So I would definitely keep in the Mystic Mine. It cheeses you games that you have no business winning otherwise. And then Necro Valley is just a good extra target to have for set rotation if you already drew the Mystic Mine. And Necro Valley can be a pretty oppressive floodgate by itself. I mean, like, the Eldritch deck, it can't banish any of its cards to keep recurring its resources. They basically have to use Golden Boy to out it, or like have Golden Boy and use Conquistador, but you can protect that with your other negation cards. And then the set rotation just functions as the third copy of both Mystic Mine and Necro Valley, if you count the Terraforming. So I think that's a really strong field spell lineup, and yeah, nothing more to say there. For the best trap in the deck, for sure it's Subterrror Final Battle. Anybody playing less than three of this is incorrect, I'm sorry. It's just so good to having those three or four different effects, and it's a not once per turn effect, So if you need to use one to make sure that your Sub-Terror cards cannot be negated, then you can do that. You can also boost in the damage step. There's a whole lot of shenanigans you can do with this card. One of my favorite interactions is you'll like search with Guru, and then they'll try to like Veiler, and then you'll use Fiendus to negate that, and then they'll use Call by the Grave to negate your Fiendus, and then you just use Sub-Terror Final Battle and say activated effects of Sub-Terror cards cannot be negated this turn. And what happens is the Sub-Terror Fiendus will still get banished, but its effect cannot be negated. So that goes through and it negates the Veiler, which then allows the Guru to go through. So it's a really cool interaction. It also works with Skill Drain, because Skill Drain lets you activate monster effects that just negates them. So when you have Final Battle, they can't be negated. It's a pretty nice interaction. Two copies of Solemn Strike. This was actually really clutch. It helps you break boards, because if you go second and you draw, say, there can be only one, and you have a strike, then if they have a monster effect to negate the activation of there can be only one, then you can make sure that that resolves. And it being a counter trap is really significant. For that reason, we also played three copies of Solemn Judgment. You have to play three copies. If you're not, you're doing it wrong. Three copies of Infinite Impermanence. I think it is probably the best hand trap right now, because it cannot be called by the Graved, and it also gets around the Kawaki Mirror Guardian when you're playing against rocks. Other than that, it's good at just stopping opponents' back row. It's stopping them from killing you on the crackback. So it's just really good and generic. And then, of course, the most oppressive floodgate in the game right now, there can be only one. It's just too good. This plus having the Guru and the Archer, it's too strong, because you just book their monster and then you shuffle it back with the Archer, and then they can only summon one monster, and then you book it and shuffle it back and just keep doing damage over and over again. So as long as that sticks, you're in really good shape. And then the last card in the deck is one copy of Metaverse. This obviously is just for the Mystic Mind, but it also does kind of help you play around cards like Lightning Storm, because if they're just going to Lightning Storm and you have no answer to it, then you can chain the Metaverse, and instead of activating a field spell, you can add it from your deck to your hand, so you're not really taking a minus there. That's just an interaction to be aware of. So that is it, 40 cards for the main deck. I found it to be really, really serviceable. And onto the side deck, we have three copies of Cumungus. I chose it just because it's an earth monster, so you can go into Ausa if you really have to, but like really that's the only reason. You could just as easily play Gamma Seal or any other kaiju really. The theory on this is if they make two negates, like the Eldritch board makes two negates, then you just kaiju the Boreload Savage Dragon and you can normal summon Guru or Archer, and then that just attacks over the Herald of Arclight, so that gets rid of two negates basically. And if you draw multiple kaijus, then you can kaiju one of their monsters and special summon your own and then attack over a weaker monster. So same concept. Three copies of Token Collector. I didn't see any Eldritch, and I also didn't see any Generator. That's a deck that I also respect. This card just destroys those token generating decks. And the fact that it can summon from the graveyard is just insane as well. It's not so good against Adamancipator, so I didn't really use it, because I didn't see any Eldritch, I just saw a bunch of Adamancipator, so that was fine. Two copies of Book of Moon. This actually was super clutch. It being a quick play spell means you can activate it in the standby phase before you can fire off your extravagance. And if they only have one negate, they're probably going to use it on the Book of Moon if you have forced it, and then your extravagance would pretty much guaranteed to go through. So that's a very, very cool interaction. I also used it on my own Guru, because I had six back row in my hand, and I'd already used the Guru effect, so I was like, you know what, I'll just put the Guru face down with the Book of Moon, set five, and then the standby phase, I used Final Battle to flip him face up, and then I added Fiendus, and I had Judgment already. So if they're going to have Lightning Storm or Evenly Matched, then I had Judgment and Fiendus to take care of both of those. Speaking of which, we play three copies of Lightning Storm, three copies of Evenly Matched. Just, if you can't stop them from making a board, then just break the board and then establish control. And then the last card, another MVP, Imperial Order, one of my all-time favorite cards. It's just so oppressive. It gets around the Lightning Storm, and you don't really play too many spells in the deck. It's really just the Pot of Greeds and the Hidden City, and you're really only using the Hidden City to get to the Guru and the Final Battle. Once you've established that, the Hidden City doesn't really matter too much anymore. So Imperial Order is definitely worth its weight in gold, if you ask me. We also, okay, we're going on to the extra deck. We have Chimeratech Fortress Dragon. This is literally just my, if I see a random Cyber Dragon matchup, then I can just contact fuse their whole board. That's really the only reason. And then the rest of it is, I never summoned any single monster in this extra deck the entire tournament, but we do have, let's see, going over here, we have three copies of Relinquished Anima, just because it's a level, or a link one that requires a level one, and it's a spellcaster, that's relevant. Link Karibo, two copies of that, just in case. For other Link 2s, we have three copies of Ausa the Earth Charmer Immovable. This is just, it's another spellcaster, again, that's relevant. It helps you to extend, and then if it dies, it searches a low defense Earth monster from your deck, so yeah, it comes up sometimes. Not very often, but moving on, we have Nightmare Phoenix, Nightmare Unicorn. Again, just generic good cards, you never summon them, but they're good. And then moving on to the other ones, we have two copies of Selene, Queen of the Master Magicians. This is why Ausa and Relinquished Anima are both relevant, because they're spellcasters. If you can establish getting to your Selene, then that helps you make your access code talker. There are two copies of there. Again, this is just a combo that you can do, but you're really realistically never going to, unless you have the craziest game ever. So that's it. That is going to wrap up this Subterror deck profile. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. Now, make sure you check out our podcast. Make sure you check out Bemani Lounge. Come and say hi, get involved in the community, and come participate in our tournaments. We host them a couple of times a week, so just check them out on the Discord, on the Facebook group, wherever your social media takes you. And that's it, guys. That's all I got for you. So hope to see you in the next one. Peace.